Hello everyone, I am Dr. Sangeeta, Assistant Professor of Physics in Chandigarh Group of Colleges, a place they speak A-class education facilities. In this video, we will discuss the basics of nuclear physics and the elementary particles. At the end of this video, you will be able to understand what and how the elementary particles are being discovered that matter made up of. Now let's start with a very simple definition of matter. Now matter is something that has mass and occupies space. People, flowers, massive bodies of the universe and everything that we see is matter. So there is a widely classification of this matter. If you look at the human flora, fauna, the basic unit of life is considered to be a cell. And a cell to have the membranes, some enzyme, they further composite of some kind of molecular structure. If we look at the other three forms of the matter, like basic three form of the matter, solids, which consist of metal, ceramics, plastics, rubber, wood, concrete, they all have a structure called the unstructured array of the molecules. Further, liquids and gases, they too have a molecular structure. And basically, what we have is a molecule. Here we have one example of molecule of sulfuric acid that doesn't connect that everyone has the sulfuric acid. It is just an example to show that how the molecules are formed. Now, it has the specific amount, like it has four oxygen atoms, one sulfur atom and two hydrogen atom. So they are connected to each other in a specific way, defining the properties of that material. And so basically we can say the molecule is a group of atoms, and atom is another smallest unit. For a very long time, scientists considered atom to be the fundamental particle, or we can say the building blocks of the matter, till the discovery of the electrons and through the radioactive decay, protons, neutrons. So let's see what is the internal structure of the atom. If we look at the definition of building block, it is the pieces of matter that make up everything, from flowers to people to the galaxies, and cannot be broken down into anything smaller. That is the smallest unit of the matter. But what we see from this figure, it shows the internal structure of the atom. We can see an atom is made up of, it consists of, in the central it has a positively charged nucleus, which has the size of 10^-14 meter. And it is surrounded by electron cloud. That cloud has the radius of 10^-10 meter. And of course, electron has a very small size as compared to the nucleus. So, but here one can specify that electron is the elementary particle and it belongs to the family of leptons. That means electron cannot be divided into further smaller unit. So one thing we notice from here, that the electron is one of the family member of leptons. The leptons are the elementary particles. One. Now we have the nucleus. Now if we look at the nucleus, the internal structure of the nucleus, it is form of protons and the neutrons. The protons are positively charged and neutrons are neutral. And further, protons and neutrons, if you look at the very wider picture of this internal structure of atom, this is the atom which has the nucleus and the electron. The electron or the lepton, as the first we discussed, is the elementary particle, and the nucleus is further has proton, or you can say neutron also. This is just an example, that proton and neutron. Further, proton is also made up of further three smaller particles called quarks. These quarks, Now, quarks are as elementary as the electron is. So, quarks cannot be divided into further smaller pieces. This is the till research we have today. And the physicists don't know of anything smaller than quarks and electron till today. Then we can say the quarks and electrons are the building blocks of matter till we find out further smaller parts of these quarks and electrons. Now let's move further. Now there is a question. It's a pose and think spot. Here you can think about the question that what holds matter together? Why the all this matter is consistent, it is attractive towards each other. You can think, you can pause the video and think about this and resume back. Welcome back to the video. So we had the question, what holds the matter together? If we say that whole matter is made of very small things, and then why don't these small things get apart from each other? Why they are sticking together? What is the reason they are sticking together? So let's understand this with a very small example. Say we have here two balls A and B. We stick these balls with some kind of elastic glue. Say this represent the glue. And what happens if we pushed these two balls away from each other? It will have the scenario like this glue will get elongated like this. But when we stop pushing it, then what happens? It retains, this glue retains back to its position and the balls will get stick together again. So that means particles, they stick together by interacting with one another in a very complex way. More specifically, we can say they exert what we call is force between them. They feel a force. For example, there are four types of fundamental forces in the nature. The first one is that we know the gravitational force. Because of that, we are standing on the earth. The earth is getting revolving around the sun, and the whole universe is stick together in the with the whole massive bodies, neutron stars, so many galaxies, and they consist of the many stars and the planets. In addition to this gravitational force, we have three another forces. The first one we can discuss is the strong forces. They generally occur between the quarks, and the another is the weak forces. Weak forces are generally responsible for the radioactive decay, and they has been exert between the two neutrinos. And the electromagnetic force, as the name suggests itself, that it is between the two charged particles. So let's see how these forces are helping us. The strong forces bind the nucleus. Now, the strong forces, one must not get confused the strong forces with the nuclear forces. First, the strong forces are the one which binds the quarks together and form the confined state of hadrons, or we can say the neutrons or the protons. However, the nuclear forces binds the neutrons and protons together to form the confined state of the nucleus. So strong forces, the forces between the quarks and the forces between the neutron and proton, they bind the nucleus together collectively. Next is the electromagnetic force. We know the atom has the positively charged central part called the nucleus, and there is an electron cloud which is negatively charged. The electron cloud is attracted with this positively charged nucleus and binds the whole atom with the help of electromagnetic force. Okay, now next is the weak force in radioactive decay. How they are helping it? They they actually exert between the, we call neutrinos. There are this also belongs to the family of leptons, as the electron is the electron neutrino, tau neutrino, and the mu neutrino. So they are responsible for the radioactive decay, specifically the beta decay. And the gravitational force binds the whole solar system, or we can the whole galaxy, or the whole universe. Let's see. The table of these forces very clearly. In the first column, we have already discussed about the particles between them, these forces are exert. Now, this next column is the strength. So, in the strength, it is a relatively calculated, of course, the strong forces being the relatively strongest and the gravitational force being the least. And there is a range of these forces to occur. Okay, the strong forces, they have the range of 10 raised to power minus 15, or you can say 1 Fermi. So they occur inside the nucleus. That's why their range is strict to that nucleus that we in this physical world, we don't interact with each other with strong forces. It is the only between the neutrons, protons, that are nuclear forces, and between the quarks, so that its range is also around that size of the nucleus. Now the electromagnetic force, they have the infinite range. However, you can say that their strength goes on decreasing as the range increases. And the weak forces, they too have a very low range, that is 10 raised to power minus 8. And because the size of the neutrino is again very small, and the work of weak forces again stick confined to the more smaller space. Gravity, it has the range of infinite, like we can say if we're sitting here, the infinite, what infinity means? It doesn't mean the not any number. For example, what infinity we can say, if I ask where is that temple in the street, then I can say that I'm standing here. You can go straight and take a left turn, there is a temple. But what if I ask you to go to the terrace and tell me where is the London, then you can say, you cannot point out, you cannot give me any direction. That is infinite at that moment. So it is the frame of reference where we can redefine the range is infinite. And for us, that the solar system is bounded, the earth is revolving around the sun, and that range we can say that is the infinite. And again, there is a huge universe, then we cannot define the what range it has, how far it is spreaded. So we can say it has a range of infinite. So next, what we are actually interested in this slide is the particle. Now, before discussing the particle for the forces, let's have a very simple example of daily life. So we as a human interact with our family members, relatives, the neighbors, colleagues, friends, anyone. So we interact with each other by exchanging something. Yes, we exchange, we definitely exchange something. That's why we are interacting. For example, if we share happiness, we share the money also, the sorrow also, the sympathy, it can be anything, emotions. And that's why we are attractive towards the other person. On the other hand, we also share the grudges. It can be, we also share the anger, we are not happy with anyone, so that is a repulsion. So basically we exchange something, that's why we are interacting, and that something is what we call is the exchange particle. The exchange particle, so in the same way, the smallest unit of the matter, we discussed quarks and the leptons, the two things we discussed that cannot be broken into other smaller pieces and is considered as the elementary particle till today. So two things we discussed already, but how they are interacting with each other is by exchanging this exchange particle, or we can say the particle by which the force is being exerted. For strong forces, the mode of the particle which is exchanged between the quarks is gluons, and between the neutrons and proton is the pion. And for the electromagnetic force, the exchange of particle is the photon. And for the weak forces, they generally interact through the bosons called W plus bosons, W zero also, W minus and Z zero, and it has very large mass and with spin 1. And the particle by which we exert the gravitational force, it is still not known to the scientists, but yes, definitely if these type of particles, they are interacting with each other by exchanging some particle, so that means gravitational force is also exert through the exchange of this particle called the graviton. This is still a mystery today, but yes, we can scientists claim that it has the spin 2, but mass is yet not known and it is considered to be zero. So let's discuss what we are interesting today is the exchange particles, the third form the elementary particle has. So what we have discussed till now in this video is the standard model of the elementary particle. There is a model, all the particles are in this table. There is a generation 1, 2 and 3, the quarks. The first one, we can say the one we discuss is the quarks, elementary particles of matter, and second we discussed the leptons, elementary particle of matter itself as it is written. But these all the elementary particles, they are interacting with each other, they are stick with each other and forming the more than 100 other particles, for example the hadrons, kaons, muons, etc. And these make such particles by interacting through this interaction, or we can say the force carrier called the bosons. Now this we can say the third number. So quarks, leptons and the force carrier or the interaction carriers. Now how they are interacting and how they are making the proton and neutron, let's say an example. So we take the quarks, the up, down, charm, strange, top and bottom, all have the mass. Now one thing to notice here in the particle physics specifically, the mass has a unit of the MeV, that is a unit of the energy, and we can say with the formula, a well known formula, E is equal to mc square. So through this the mass has the unit, the m is equal to E by c square, that's why it is written MeV, which is a unit of energy, by c square. And all the fundamental particles, their mass is defined in the same way, so that gv by c square, it has the higher mass, of course it is gv, and it is also having in the range of gv, but up and down they are having the mass in MeV. So these properties of these particles in the standard model, they are identified. So let's have a very simple example of proton, how they are made of. Let's say we have up and the down quark. I consider three quarks, two up quarks and one is the down quark. Let's calculate the charge first. For example, charge. So what is the charge of the up quark? It is 2 by 3 plus again 2 by 3 minus the mass of the charge of the this charge let's start again. Okay, so there was, so I am considering the charge of up and down, then we will also consider the spin also. So this is 2/3 plus again 2/3 down. It has a negatively charge, so -1/3, and it comes out to be 1. So it is the positive, it is the mass of the proton. Spin, let's check the spin also. The spin of up quark is 1/2, and the spin of again up quark is 1/2, then the spin of down quark is -1/2. So what we have is the 1/2 spin, and we know the proton is a 1/2 spin particle. So that means 2 up quarks and 1 down quarks, they combine together, they, we can make the diagram like this. U, they are interacting with the gluon. It is generally defined by this U and D. So this is the structure of a proton. And similarly for a neutron, we have the structure like U, D and D quark. Again, they are also intact in this proton through the gluons. So next, coming to the electromagnetic forces, they interact through the photons, and the weak forces are through the Z bosons and W bosons. So here one theory comes out to be that the charged particles, they interact through the photons, and the weak forces also, they are also charged. The leptons, like in beta decay, there is a decay of the positron. Okay, so positron is the antimatter, or you can say anti-electron, we can say the proton. So they are interacting through the, they are charged particle, they are also interacting through the bosons, which is generally the force carrier of weak forces, and through the photon, which is the electromagnetic force carrier. And how these two forces are they are combined together, and there is a theory given by Peter Higgs, and he explained that in some way both the forces are connected to each other, and there is a particle which is responsible for the mass. Because till the discovery of gluons, photons, Z bosons and W boson, we didn't know from where the mass is coming out. So the discovery of, in 1964 he started the work, in 1970 he developed the theory, but in 2012 the Higgs boson was first discovered experimentally and confirmed its all the properties matching to the properties that was predicted by the Peter Higgs, and it's being named with the with Higgs boson. So this is generally responsible for the mass in the particles. So coming to the next slide, here it is shown the beta decay. Generally what happens in a weak forces, especially this is a beta decay radioactivity. So what happens in the weak forces, we have a proton converts into the neutron, and we know it is D and 2U, two up quarks and one is down. Here we have two down quarks and one up. So two will remain same without any interaction, they will not change itself. So what is changing? Proton is not converting into the neutron, it's generally one up quark. One up quark is converting into the down quark through the weak interactions by exchanging the particle W plus. On the other hand, if we reverse it, it exchange the particle W minus. The direction is reversed, then we can say it is through the W plus and this is through the W minus. And what we have in the output, here we have the electron and the electron neutrino. And in this we have electron here and the electron neutrino. In the same way, just the exchange of the boson is different. Here we have W plus and W minus, and this is how the proton and neutron are converting. If we consider the neutron converting to proton, then we will have the positron here and the antineutrino. Okay, but now here is a pause and think spot in the video, that how do we know that? How do you know that proton is made of this quarks and neutron is made of this quarks, and this is how they are converting from each other? So let's, you can pause the video and think about this question and resume back. Welcome back to the video. We had the question, how do we know the protons and the neutrons, they are made up of this quarks, and their quarks are further interacting with gluons, and the protons are converting into the neutrons through the weak forces by exchanging the W bosons. So before answering this question, let's have a very quick review of the nuclear physics. As we know, the nucleus is defined by an atomic symbol, and it has some mass number. Let's, for example, for oxygen 8, capital O is the symbol, 16 its mass number, N is the neutron number, that is the 8 in case of oxygen, and Z, the proton number, is again 8. In a nuclear reaction, one nucleus, it is a target nucleus, and another is the projectile. When the projectile is boosted towards the target nuclei, it gives an output nuclei with some kind of nucleons. It can be one neutron, two neutron in the output, neutron and proton collectively, or two protons, and simply the gamma rays also. And it is defined by this equation, a nuclear reaction, where A is the target nuclei and rest, and it is at rest position. B is the projectile nuclei, and we have bombarded, in this example, we have bombarded the oxygen nucleus with the one neutron. And here the neutron is the projectile, that means it has some kind of energy, and boosted towards the oxygen, the target nuclei, give the result is the nitrogen nucleus with the one proton, that is, you can say one hydrogen. And in the same way, the nuclear reactions occur on the basis of the binding energy curve. We know this is a binding energy curve. And what is the binding energy? That energy is used to bind the nucleus. For example, we have here the mass of proton, we know, and total mass of the helium. In this, in this side, we have the helium 4 atom with 2 proton and 2 neutrons. And in this tray, we have 2 protons, like 2 protons individually, and 2 neutrons. They are not binded. We are just calculating and comparing the masses. What we found is the mass of 2 neutron and 2 proton is more than the combined helium. That means there is a mass defect, that is the delta M. This mass defect is the reason, and it is responsible for the binding energy. So all the nucleus from mass 1 to the as many as you can say the 250 mass, there is a binding curve, and the nucleus which have the mass below 14, they have the low binding energy, and nucleus beyond this curve, they have the again low binding energy as compared to the nucleus here, as compared to the nucleus lies here. Like, for example, the maximum binding energy is of the iron 58. So every nucleus wants to be in a stable state. So in order to become stable, they react with each other and comes to the this stage. For example, the lower nucleus, which the lies in this range, they generally yield from the nuclear fusion, and the nucleus which are lie in this range, they undergoes the nuclear fission reactions. So let's understand briefly both the reactions, how they are working. So this is the nuclear fission reaction. We can say this is the uranium. This is uranium 235. 235 is the mass, and 92 is its proton number, and it is injected. There is an injection of one neutron, which is a thermal neutron. Since it has some kind of energy associated with it, it is a projectile, and uranium is the target, and it undergoes make a daughter nuclei. Can be anything, we can call it a compound nucleus, and it live for the 10 days to power minus 28 seconds only, and form the two daughter nuclei So they form the two daughter nuclei. Beryllium and the krypton with mass 141, and krypton has a mass of 92 plus the 3 neutrons in the output. So the reaction will go as a chain reaction, which is responsible with you and used in a nuclear reactors, and we had the electricity from those reactors, and we can see the again a wide picture of that was the first reaction, one you can say single form, and there is a chain reaction, and this is how the you can see in the video that uranium is burst into the two beryllium and krypton nuclei with the 3 neutrons. So next is the nuclear fusion reaction. What are the nuclear fusion reaction? In this, two smaller nuclei, generally here is the two hydrogen, deuterium and tritium, they combine together to form a helium 4, giving the output as a one neutron, and this neutron has the energy of 14.1 MeV, and plus this we have 3.5 MeV of the energy released out. So this kind of the reaction are going on the our star, that center of the solar system is Sun. And how these nuclear fusion reaction are going on, these two nuclei also combines together with some kind of attractive force, like in the Sun there is a very high gravitational force of coming from the core of the Sun, and these and it has a huge nuclear fuel is the hydrogen, and hydrogen nucleuses, they are combining together and forming the hydrogen and giving a huge endless amount of energy. And Sun is going on from since last billions years, and it will go on and burn on like this in next billion years also. And this is the schematic view of combining the deuterium and tritium and giving the energy of 3.5 MeV and the nucleon, and here is the molecular view, or you can see the nuclear view, exactly the nuclear view. Now there is a pause and think spot of again how one can see the internal structure of the nucleons. We discussed till yet that we had some kind of incident energy in any form, and two nucleus they are combining together to form a bigger one, or they are undergoes the fission and divided into the two smaller nuclei, but with some kind of incident energy. So that can we can say in that sense that fission, in fission, the uranium nucleus is made up of two daughter nuclei, that barium and krypton, and the three neutrons. If we can skip one neutron which was in the projectile section, so we can say two nuclei, barium and krypton, and two neutron. It consists of this, like a very sort of thing we can have. The uranium is barium, krypton, neutron, and neutron. This is the one kind of thought we can. But can we know how the protons, they have the quark structure? How do we know that? So it is a pause and think spot. You can pause the video, think about the question, and resume back. Welcome back to the video. We had the question, how one can see the internal structure of the nucleons. So let us understand and answer this question from a very kind of, again, irrelevant example of medical field. So there is a microscope we have, and we see the chick cells through the low power magnifying power of the microscope. Then this is how they are seen through the lenses, and when we increase, of course, the picture is getting wider and wider, and towards we can see clearly the cytoplasm, the bacteria, nucleus, and the membranes of this chick cells clearly. Moreover, if we attach this microscope with a scale, we can actually calculate the size of the cell too, and to the size of the nucleus in the cell. So similarly, in the same way, the magnifying power is helping the medical science. And here the incident energy, how it works, here we are hitting a glass sheet with a stone. What happens, it will get fragmented into many pieces. But if we shoot the glass with the bullet, it has the moderate speed, then it will crumble into some pieces and have a hole here. In this scenario, there was not any hole. But if the bullet hits the glass sheet with a very high speed, it will have a sharp hole in the glass. And we can also say that if we hit a ball with a plastic ball, a bigger ball is hitted by a plastic ball, it will merely move from its speed. But if this ball is of rubber ball, then what will happen, it will get displaced from the position. And suppose we made it stationary, we made this ball stationary and hitting it with the iron ball, then this will definitely crumble into the pieces. And this is how the increase in incident energy works. In the nuclear reactions, again coming back to the topic, in low energy incident energies, the projectile is hitting the target nuclei and it is forming the dinuclear system, then the compound nucleus, it may go into the quasi fission or fast fission, deep inelastic scattering of this dinuclear system, and also the compound nucleus can undergo towards the fission fragments, or it can make the one single daughter nuclei with the fusion product. Now what happens if we increase this energy? We increase the energy of this projectile, then what happens, the projectile will hit the target nuclei. So when it is hitting, it has the same energy, same density, that the normal density of the nuclear matter is like rho naught is equal to 0.17 Fermi raised to power minus 3. So when it hits the projectile nuclei, hits a target, it will form a pre-equilibrium compressed zone, because it is being heated very fast, it combines together, it has the one form, and of course the density of this participant zone, having the collision dynamics, the density will definitely increase. And then there occur a expansion zone. Once the material, nuclear material combines, and after some time it retain back and get fragmented into many many pieces, and some of the nuclei, they are unstable, so they may undergo the secondary decay, and this is being detected in a 4-pi detector unless we have a beam of the target and projectile nuclei. Unless this position, we can have a complete 4-pi structure of the so many detectors. Now, how the detector is working? It's okay, we cannot see the neutrons, we cannot see the protons, because they have very very small size, even can't be seen through the microscopes. But yes, they have spin, they have some properties, they have charge. We can detect these all the particles, the small particles, through the detectors by calculating their charge, their behavior in the scintillation counters, their tracks, and their of course their direction of motion. So we have a 4-pi structure, the direction of motion also tells us that how these are fragmented and what are the properties of those material. So this we can say, the two projectile nuclei, they are made up of these so many fragments of the nuclei. Now next, what happen if we increase more and more energy and only consider not the nuclei, not the projectile and target nuclei, just the two particles, like two protons, two electrons, then what will happen? And so one more thing to discuss is, in this scenario, the nuclear reaction is generally named as a nuclear collisions. There are collision dynamics in because they are colliding and they are fragmented into many many pieces, like the stone is collide with the sheet, the bullet is shooted on the glass sheet in the same manner. So now the particle collision at very high energy, and here high energy or the particle physics, here the incident energy is generally greater than 2 GeV. Why 2 GeV? We have the proton and neutron structure. The mass of the neutron, okay, this is generally equal to 1 GeV, or we can say the 939 MeV, and proton is generally again 1 GeV, approximately they are 1 GeV. If we want to break the nucleus, then one must have the incident energy above the binding energy, that is 8.8 MeV. That we can, if we are colliding the two nucleus, we want to know its structure, we can have the incident energy range up to the 8.5 MeV, or we can say the 10 MeV. But if we want to collide and want the fragmented form of the nuclear matter, then this can go up to the 2 GeV. But if we want to break this neutrons and proton, we have to provide the energy which is larger than the size of this neutron and proton. As we discussed earlier in the same video, that the mass is generally in terms of the energy. So we need to provide the combined energy is 2 GeV to look at the internal structure of the nucleons. So here is a some picture, like positron and electron, they are interacting and giving the photons in the output. And here is a particle, is like, for example, two protons are interacting, they again go back to again two proton, but by some giving the output of the two photons. And also, this is the main thing we want to discuss, whenever the two particle, there is a particle collider, and in that, whenever two single particle, that elementary particle we discussed, we want to search them, then we have to collide protons and proton, proton and neutrons, proton with electrons, so that we can find out what's inside the proton. If we want to explore proton, we need to break it, and we break it through the particle collider. And when particle collider, these two are boosted towards each other, and collide with each other, there is a shower of fundamental particles. It's well known that if we say in the first video that proton is made up of three quarks, then that means when they collide with each other, they will have output as a quark in the detectors. So this is the how we can find out the new particles. This is the way we find out, we increase the energy of the nuclear reactions, then we can find out the nuclear. As we can find out the internal structure of the nucleus, then again here, if we collide the particles, protons and protons, neutrons and protons, then we will have the shower of again fundamental particles, which are the, we can say the, I have found the new particle. These are quarks, leptons and the interacting bosons. Now next we have the European Council of Nuclear Research. This is a very this is the aerial view of this the CERN, we can call it, and it is the most world's best particle collider, and it has most complex instrument to discover the new, to look at the new particles by colliding the other particle. And it has, it is spreaded, this LHC is at the distance of 27 kilometers. So in this 27 kilometers, one particle will have the around 11,000 rotations. 11,000 rotations a proton is having at the speed of nearly equal to the light, and it is colliding with the other proton which was having the same number of rounds in a opposite direction. And in a very, again in a outline view, this is the particle detector of CERN called the Large Hadron Collider. What it does, that it gives the two particles, for example two protons from here. Now this particle detector is also works for the nuclear also, but here what we are looking for is a discovery of elementary particles. So yes, we will consider the proton and proton here. What the CERN and LHC, the team is doing, that one proton is having rounds in a clockwise direction and other is in anti-clockwise direction, and there are two different tubes for that, and there is a circular motion, and they are having rounds, and with each round the speed of the proton is increasing, the incident energy is increasing. And when we achieve that energy that we want to detect, because it consists of many detectors, that ATLAS, CMS, LHC-B, SPS, ALICE, and these are the different detectors situated in the LHC. So depending upon the what energy we want to collide the protons or particles, we can have the detection of the particle after the collision. So next is a clear view you can see in this small video. It is a particle accelerator, the linear particle accelerator. For example, the proton beam is it is going linearly in one direction. There is a tube, so this tube it is moving in one direction. It has another tube, so this is basically two tubes situated with each other, and after every turn it has the superconducting magnets that is the bending the beam in that area, so that it will move smoothly without interacting towards the boundaries of this this tube. And of course it is in ultra high vacuum. So this is the one detector, say ATLAS detector, and here what we have when the two protons or two particles collide with each other, and this very fundamental particles crumble out of this reaction, and it is being again detected with a 4-pi detectors, and we have the 3D view of these detections. So there are so many events. Why there are so many lines is that there is a beam, there is not a single proton is moving in that in that tube, there is a beam of the beam of the proton, and after every it is called the event. We can say that one proton is colliding with another proton, it's one event, and another in this is the beam, and 1, 2, 3 there is a beam of protons again from one side, another proton comes and another antiproton comes. Why antiproton? Because it is having the totally opposite direction of motion. So, and one another thing it's to remember, it has a speed equivalent to, not exactly equal to, equivalent to, just smaller than the speed of the light, and we can detect these particles. So every event is counting, and every event is represented as a line, or can say that the path of the particle covered. Okay, so this is what happens when two proton beams collide at nearly light speed. So this is what we make sense of in this video, that we discussed a standard model which consists of fundamental particles of matter, the quarks and the leptons, and by which these quarks and leptons are interacting with each other and forming other other particles, and then those other particles like proton and neutron, they are making nucleus and electron, they are making an atom, atoms combining together making the nucleus, and nucleus have the different properties on the basis of different its specific direction of bonds it have, the specific bonds the atoms, different atom it has. So depending upon the structure of the nucleus, there are so many materials in the world, from the people, flower and to the galaxies. So this is what we make sense of today. Thank you so much.